The finance minister surprised a few people at budget time in May when he revealed the government's developing an unemployment insurance scheme. Canada has had a similar scheme, called employment insurance, in place since the 1930s. Now, there's very little detail about the New Zealand program at the moment, but Q&A understands it's being roughly modelled on the Canadian scheme. I asked economics professor Moshe Lander how Canada's program works.
So the basic idea is that it is a what we call a pay-as-you-go system. So everybody who's currently working right now in Canada has to contribute about 5% of their income up to a maximum amount, and that money is used to pay for current unemployed people. So it's not like you have an individualized account that's for you just in case things go bad with your job. It's you're paying for current unemployed, and so as people are more unemployed or less unemployed, the amount that we contribute might change at the margin, but it's effectively about 5% up to a maximum of around, say, $3,000.
Right. And to be clear, who qualifies for EI support?
So it started off as something very simple, that if you're out of a job, you qualify. But of course, you know, like with any legislation in any part of the world, they start adding exemptions, exceptions, add-ons. And so it's usually the idea that if you haven't used it within, say, the last year or so, then you're eligible to be able to use it up to a certain maximum amount of time based on how long you were employed before that. And also based on what your income is going to determine how much you're compensated.
Okay, can you unpack that a little bit more for us? To be clear, is EI a supplementary welfare system? Are there other support systems that are available to support people who are out of work?
Yeah, so there are plenty of other programs out there that you can qualify for. So employment insurance is one of them. So if you had a job and then you lost it and it's for, let's say, a legitimate reason, right? Not that you decided to quit and you just want to live on the dole for the rest of your life. But if you lost your job because of an economic downturn, they're downsizing or something like that, then you basically have to fill out a form. These days it's all online. And you would have to provide something from your employer saying that you legitimately lost your job. At that point, after a period of about 6 weeks, then you start qualifying. Now, you might qualify for other programs as well. And what happens then is the amount that you receive is means tested. So if you're receiving lots of money from some other source, then the amount that you qualify for employment insurance would be different than if you didn't qualify for any other things. If you have a family with kids, as opposed to being single, older, younger, all of those things are going to kind of determine the amount that you qualify for. But it's essentially a short waiting period. And if you haven't used it prior, let's say about 12 to 18 months before.
Okay. So you made it clear that individuals can't ring fence their contributions. So if I were to lose my job, I don't only qualify for the money that I have contributed to the scheme. However, do higher earners qualify for more money under employment insurance?
Yeah, so you qualify usually for some percentage of your income, but even there, it's up to a limit, right? So you could imagine that if somebody's in the corporate suite and they're earning tens of millions of dollars a year and they lose their job, they're not going to start qualifying for millions of dollars in EI support. That would be outrageous for the taxpayer to have to foot that bill. So once you reach a certain threshold, then it starts leveling off that this is the maximum that you qualify for. But at low levels of income, it's usually not 100% of your income. The idea is that you don't want to make it too generous that you don't go looking for a job, but you don't want to make it so ungenerous that you feel that you have to grab the first job along the way either. And so every politician will constantly tweak with that as a new party comes in. This is something that they want to review depending on whether they're left or right of centre.
And what sort of range do you see? So I can imagine that, you know, under some political parties, perhaps you qualify for 80% of your previous wage for a certain period. And then under other political parties, perhaps it's slightly less.
That's exactly it. So it's about 60 to 80%, assuming that you are a typical medium income earner. So in Canada, the median income is around $50,000. I think in New Zealand, it's roughly about the same if you take GDP divided by the number of New Zealanders. And given that our dollars are roughly in line with each other, then your viewers would be able to appreciate that if you're earning around, say, 40 to 50,000 New Zealand dollars a year, you would qualify for about 60 to 80% of that, depending on the political party, up to, say, a maximum of anywhere from 16 weeks to 6 months, again, depending on the generosity of the party involved.
Okay, up to 6 months. But in order to qualify for this, you have to contribute 5% of your wage. There will be some people who say that's a very high cost.
It is a high cost. And to add to it, that when I'm talking about that we, the employee, are contributing 5%, in Canada, the employer is also required to contribute 5%. And so it drives a rather large wedge beyond just income taxes and all of the other deductions that we experience on our paycheck. Effectively, you're adding a 10% wage wedge between what the employer is effectively giving you and what you're taking home. And so, yeah, it's a very heavy contribution, but because it maxes out, that you don't have to contribute that money beyond, say, about $50,000 a year, then the fact is that you require a rather hefty sort of tax, because high-income earners, if they're earning $100,000 a year, then their deductions stop around the end of June because they've reached that $50,000 limit, that no more 5% deductions take place.
Right. Okay, I understand. How has the system worked for COVID-19?
So they were a lot more generous with EI. They extended the amount of benefits, and they introduced a brand new program, which in Canada we've called CERB. This was over top of that, where we were basically handing anybody who had, breath in their body, about $1,000 to $2,000. And depending on their means, they could qualify for that over top of EI. The discussion right now in Canada is, as we're coming hopefully to what's the tail end of COVID, what do we do with CERB? Do we roll it into EI? Do we make EI more generous, less generous? Or do we eliminate EI altogether and retain this CERB program, which was a very generous sort of EI system?
It's interesting. Here in New Zealand, the government hasn't released much detail on the program at the moment. Indeed, they are consulting as they try and design New Zealand's program. But they introduced it off the back of COVID-19, when a lot of New Zealanders who felt that they were very secure in their jobs all of a sudden were forced to reckon with the insecurity that the pandemic has brought to our economies. And really, employment insurance is not the kind of system that is actually designed for a large-scale shock such as COVID-19, is it? It's a system that actually works better in normal times.
You're exactly right. And the thing is that when you introduce these systems in the face of an economic shock, so COVID, of course, is a huge one. For New Zealand, of course, an economic slowdown in China would have devastating effects as well, right? You don't want to introduce policy at the height of a crisis or on the back end of a crisis, because usually what you end up doing is you introduce something that's overly generous. And so while it seems reasonable in the time, especially when everybody's afraid, a few years down the line, when you realize that because you're using this pay-as-you-go system, what's going to happen is you're not going to have the money to keep paying for those generous benefits, right? And that's when things are going to get ugly, where once you start saying that I'm cutting benefits to unemployed people, this becomes highly politicized. And so the best thing to do is, you know, a slow, gradual introduction where it starts off not particularly generous, not particularly long, merely to kind of trial balloon and see how people get used to it. And then you can increase the generosity as the economy recovers, and you can see what a full business cycle is going to look like in a post-pandemic world.
And Moshe, would you have any other advice for New Zealand policymakers who are designing the system here?
You know, I think what I would want to see from a data standpoint, if I can be kind of academic, is I'd like to see how many people in New Zealand are unemployed, but I'd also like to see things like the duration of unemployment. So if you tell me that, you know, 1 out of 20 New Zealanders are unemployed, that's great. But if it's the same 1 out of 20 people that are consistently unemployed, employment insurance is not going to solve that problem, right? The problem is that somehow they're missing skills to get them back into the labor force. But if it's a rotating band of 1 out of 20 people, that this month it's this group, this month it's this group, then the system could work really well. But you need to be able to see those details beyond just the idea that unemployment spiked during COVID. Who were those people? And of course, are they North Islanders, South Islanders? Are they in the cities? Are they out in the rural parts of the nation? And so those are the types of things that you need to realize, that if it's going to be an effective insurance scheme, it really does need to cover all New Zealanders and all the risks that they face, not just particular segments. Otherwise, it's going to become very resented by people who have stable jobs, stable incomes, and feel that they're just subsidizing people who don't seem to want to figure out how the labor market works.